possibly the most boring section of digital audio, but important. Strand 5, Standard 1, what is copyright? Number 1, what is fair use in copyright law? In its most general sense, a fair use is any copying of copyrighted material done for a limited and transformative purpose, such as to comment upon, criticize, or parody a copyrighted work. Such uses can be done without permission from the copyright owner. I don't always recommend that. I think you should probably get permission every time you possibly can if you're going to make money off of it so you don't get sued. But fair use means that for a limited amount, and in education we actually have that, it's kind of in the contract of government, that educational purposes can use a little bit of content without having to ask a copyright owner. So an English teacher can take some excerpts from a novel and hand them out to the class and they can read them, and she didn't get permission from the copyright owner to have a couple of pages of a novel. Similarly, we can do some things like that, and especially if we're doing it for, well, not just for education, but for like analyzing it for critical purposes. Like we could do a radio broadcast of a movie show. KSL has the movie show. And we can play some clips of a movie and then talk about that. That was my favorite part of the movie. I thought it was so funny when she slapped him on the face and then he threw a glass of water at her in retaliation, and then she picked up the whole pitcher and dumped it on him. That was great. You know, you can actually talk about the movies. You can quote some lines. That is fair use. Also, parody is up there. That's my favorite fair use in the copyright law, which means you can actually make fun of something. Weird Al Yankovic used to do that a lot with Michael Jackson songs. And he would get permission, but he didn't have to.
I've always been a great fan of yours. I've got all your records, and I was just wondering how you'd feel about my doing a parody of Beat It called, Eat It.
Thanks a lot. You won't be sorry. Oh, I don't believe this. This is great. Hey, thanks again. This is great. I can't believe it. Oh, I can't believe it. Oh, Jack. I'll send you test pressing as soon as it's ready. Really, thank you so much. What a spot. This is great. I can't believe it. What a nice guy.
We did say what is copyright, but I didn't actually say anything about that. We should just talk about that for a second. So copyright is the fact that once you've created something, it's yours, and then you just have to prove it. So it is copyrighted. If I sing a song and it's my original song, that is automatically copyrighted. And if someone steals that song and tries to make money off of it, I can sue them and say, ah, that was my song. You can register your copyright with the Library of Congress. It used to cost about $50. I'm not sure how much it is now. You do it online now. You used to have to mail it in. Or if you just have some way of proving it, if all of your friends saw you sing that song and that was your song and it's recorded, then you go to a court of law and all your friends come and say, it was in Mr. Walker's class in Studio ALA. I was a witness to it. Plus, this recording is time-stamped September of 2020. So you have proven that you are the copyright owner. It's not copywritten, by the way. It's copyrighted if you're using past tense. Okay, but it does say number 2, when in doubt, asking permission from the copyright owner will avoid a lawsuit. Okay, so depending on how big the artist is, the blogger, the vlogger, or the podcast, depending on how big they are, they may belong to unions. I hope I have that here somewhere. I'm not sure if I talk about unions here. And it may come up as flagged. You've probably all seen on YouTube that things can be blocked. But as soon as someone is trying to make money off of someone else's copyrighted material, if it's a big enough artist, they will sue you. Okay, so Disney sues everybody. They have teams of lawyers that just look for ways to sue someone for using their characters. If I even tried to talk like Donald Duck, which I don't think I can do, he's always mad, right? If I did that on a radio commercial, Disney could sue me. Moving on. Strand 6, Career Readiness and Student Associations. You can participate in TSA, Technology Student Association, or Skills USA. Also, the Utah Broadcast Awards. Skills USA is something that pretty much all high schools across the country are encouraged to use. That wouldn't surprise me at all if that comes up on the state test. But it does cost a little bit of money, and ALA does not pay for it for you, so you'd have to pay your own club dues. And so I'm not telling you that you have to do it. Standard 1 job titles. Let's see now, after we've been going over these things forever, it seems like. Let's see if you can fill in the blanks on your own. An audio or a sound what? The same as if you're running a train. You're a train. I'm not going to finish it for you. Maybe this one I will, because we haven't said this one too much. If you're in charge of the overall audio show, program, podcast, song, album, whatever, you are an audio producer. P-R-O-D-U-C-E-R. You're a performer of sound effects. You are a Foley what? Activist. If anyone writes that down, you owe me a candy. What are you really? Number 7, you perform on a microphone, especially like on radio and on audiobooks, I would say, is most of the time you see a voice. It'd be fun to actually make up something different for all of these. I can't come up with what would work there, though. A voice teenager. Okay, this one might be a little more difficult, number 8. Yeah, because I don't even give you any hints of what this is. This is pretty much the same as a audio, the first one. Oh, I'll say it now because you already passed it. Let's see if you got it right. An audio engineer is just another way of saying it. And it usually is in a bigger situation, certainly video or something like that. Or maybe you're just the guy that's always assigned on campus. BYU probably has audio technicians. And they just assigned to be that on campus. Hey, we need some audio set up over here in the library. Get an audio technician. Number 9, a sound designator. No, that's not what it is. A sound designer. That's a fun field.
The lightsabers are one of my favorite sounds, and in fact it was the very first sound I made for the whole series. For some reason, after I read the script, even though my assignment was first to find a voice for Chewbacca and then a voice for R2, and then maybe come up with some sounds for laser guns and other things, the lightsaber fascinated me. At that time, when the script had first come out, they had some paintings that Ralph McQuarrie had done, so that there were some concepts visually of what some of these things would look like. I could kind of hear the sound in my head of the lightsabers, even though it was just a painting of a lightsaber. I could really just sort of hear the sound, I think maybe somewhere in my subconscious. I was carrying a microphone across the room between recording. I was recording something over here, and I walked over here with the microphone, passed by a television set, which was on the floor, which was on at the time, without the sound turned up, but the microphone passed right behind the picture tube, and as it did, this particular microphone produced an unusual hum. It picked up transmission from the television set, and a signal was induced into its sound reproducing mechanism. Once we had established this tone of the lightsaber, of course you had to get the sense of the lightsaber moving, because characters would carry it around, they'd whip it through the air, they would, of course, thrust and slash at each other in fights. And to achieve this additional sense of movement, I played the sound over a speaker in a room, and then took another microphone and waved it around in the air next to that speaker so that it would come close to the speaker and go away. You could whip it by. And what happens when you do that by recording with a moving microphone is you get a Doppler shift, you get a pitch shift in the sound, and therefore it gave the lightsaber a sense of movement and it worked well on screen at that point.
And we probably have about 30 full-time sound designers working at Hollywood right now.